Using the principles he teaches, Colton Lindsay became ranked in the top 1% of the sales agents in his real estate market by the age of 28. He averages selling 75 homes a year, working 4 days a week. I love it. Colton Lindsay is internationally recognized as a prospecting expert, inner game master, and a financial freedom teacher. Featured in Top Agent magazine as an agent that doesn't use a bag of tricks and producer of best-selling Winning the Inner Game, audiophiles, and several other trainings and courses, including Financial Freedom Nation. Colton Lindsay is one of North America's most exciting trainers and presenters. His YouTube channel has empowered thousands of real estate agents to dramatically increase their confidence and skills. He uses breakthrough techniques and accelerated learning technologies so that agents can learn faster, remember more, and accomplish extraordinary results. All right. Colton Lindsay's motto is, "You can't do a half-assed job in real estate sales or life." With his unique ability to get agents to take immediate action and produce massive results, along with create financial freedom through cash flow management, his training changes agents' lives. Colton, are you ready to run this thing? All right. Rock and roll, man. You're now live on the air. So grateful to have you, man. We're going to have a lot of fun today. And I know you have a ton of experience, ton of success you've been experiencing lately. And things weren't always so great. So let's start a little bit back before you've been, you know, blowing up lately. But what was the journey like to get here? What were some of the challenges that you've overcome? And share a little bit about that with our audience, man.
Yeah, dude, I think the biggest thing for me was just believing in the impossible. Right? Like, we have all these roadblocks in our head, and it clicked for me once I realized I didn't have to fight to create what I wanted to create, but I had to allow what I wanted to create. And I don't know if you've noticed this, Chris. Do you ever have this like negative conversation in your head, and then all of a sudden you start talking back to it with a positive conversation, like, right? So you start this fucking conversation in your head. And what I finally realized is, dude, just like leave the conversation and let's go into action. And so then I just started 10Xing my action and just like, it just went from there.
Wow. And how long ago did you make that shift?
I mean, I think like it's always kind of been slowly happening my entire life. But so 2012 is when I first had, you know, I had went through Mastermind experience or intensive with Doug Nelson. That's when I realized, okay, I could create financial freedom. Right. And then I learned what they taught with the JAR system and managing your cash flow. And then so from there to spring of 2016, it took me probably like 4 years to where I could just readjust and go to financial freedom and to where I'm at now. And now I'm on a journey to 10X that financial freedom. I mean, I want to hit it to where I'm at $200,000 a month in passive residual income. And so it's so doable. I think in the next 24 months, that's where I'll be at.
Beautiful. And then before that Millionaire Mind experience, were you doing personal development, number one? And then two, were you like experiencing bad results? Were you like mediocre? What was happening before that?
Yeah. So I was, I had been into personal development since probably 2005 was when I first,
awesome.
My first touch of it, I was actually on a service mission for my church in Brazil, and I came across the book How to Win Friends and Influence People. Nice. And I read it in Portuguese, right? So I read that book in Portuguese, and like all of a sudden, like I realized, hold on, there's like a whole new world of thinking. And that was when I just scratched the surface. Then, you know, in my early 20s, from like 21 to 24, I was making good money in real estate. Like, good money for me at 23, 24 is 6 figures, 100K a year. But I was blowing it, you know, through, you know, partying and alcohol and whatever, right? Just being stupid. Then I was blessed. I met my wife. I totally turned a different direction with that part of my life. And I started making really decent money till about 2012. You know, I think 2012, I had hit about 220,000 in revenue that year. But that was before I cash flow management. I was just kind of a saver or a hoarder. So I wasn't doing anything with it. Then when I started, you know, each year kind of leap year after that, like it expanded. And then I got really great at managing the cash flow as it flows into me and then the direction that it would flow out. And so it just exponentially just grow at that point, you know. And then I stopped looking at, okay, instead of making like 6 to 8% of my money, why can't I make 12 to 15? And then once it got from 12 to 15, why can't I do 20 to 25% return on my cash? You know what I'm saying? Yes. And then it just kind of grew from there.
Wow. So what are the investments that you're involved in these days? Where do you find yourself getting the most return on investment?
Totally. And I see it obviously as four pillars of wealth. And I teach this in Financial Freedom Nation, which number one is real estate. I have a background of real estate. I believe everyone should own real estate. However, I will note, Chris, for people that are watching this, whether live or recorded or however you do it, mm-hmm. I do believe your personal home is the biggest liability that you can have in your life. However, you can turn those liabilities into assets by using them as inflow, cash inflow properties. So real estate is huge for me. Number two is the stock market. The stock market, I believe, is where you can get the highest returns on your cash passively, right? And then number three for me is precious metals and commodities, which is more of just to be able to hold money when you're not using it. Mm-hmm. And then number four is business. You know, business for me is always – the fastest way to grow cash, and it's where you can take the nothing into something. And so through that, I mean, you can break it down into different ways. I've done medium money loans for, you know, 10 to 12% interest return. I love owning Facebook. We're doing this on Facebook, right? I love owning Amazon because I think I order everything on Amazon. I love owning Apple because everything I do is Apple. I love owning Google because Google does everything for me as well, right? And then Netflix because my kids watch Netflix, right? So I invested in companies that work for me. Mm-hmm. And like, I mean, this year alone, which the stock market's doing awesome, but what are we, middle of May? And I think I'm already at like 16, 17% return on my cash in 5 months. So it's like, that's not to say it's going to happen year after year after that, but you start, once the cash flows, and I don't want this conversation to go on my investments, because once the cash flows to it, you can get great returns. But the challenge that I see with everyone, Chris, is they don't ever get to make the investment. They never get the money to invest because they've blown it before because they have no cash management system.
So let's dive in, man. What do we need to know about that cash management system, or, you know, where are people falling short? What are people stuck with?
Cool. So I have currently in one of my courses, Financial Freedom Nation. Like when people register for that course, and I think you even have did you get the link I sent
to
you?
Yep, I got
cool.
It.
So part of that, when they start to sign up for the course, they have to apply ahead of time before they can put in their information and purchase it. And so I have all this data of information from typically the people that want to take it are either self-employed or they are employees with the corporation or the government, right? And a couple of the questions asked in there is, do you have a financial management cash flow system that you use? Do you have a system to manage your cash flow? And then the other question that I ask is, if you do have one, how often are you referring to it and analyzing it and putting attention on it, right? So check this out. I would imagine that this is like globally very similar numbers, but 90% of the applicants in the course don't have a management system at all. Zero. Zilch. Nada. Not even like a basic don't even know your budget sort of thing, right? And then of the 10% that do have a system, they only look at it one or less times per month, meaning once a month or once a quarter, right? So that to me is very clear that people just don't have a system. They don't know. And I think you know as well as me, like, at what point in your life were you taught how to manage your cash flow? Was it in kindergarten? Was it in elementary? Was it in middle school? Was it in high school? Was it in college? Like, when did they teach you that shit? They never did. No one, my parents didn't teach me. My church didn't teach me. School didn't teach. No one fucking taught me, right? And everyone else has this problem. And unfortunately, I believe it's stacked against us. And so I'm on a mission to help as many people as I can. Like, how can we change this? You can create this. Like, I'm nothing special, right? I just followed the formula that I learned from people that were smarter and more successful than me, and I applied it immediately.
Wow. And so are you able to share that formula with us, or do people have to go into the Financial Freedom Nation?
So I mean, I can give you the gist of it, right? But like, to really dive into it, like, Financial Freedom Nation is an 8-week training we're over an hour per week, plus you have interactive questions and things like that, plus we have our coaching platform with it as well. So I can give you the gist of it, but just the gist of it is only going to get you so far, okay, right? So it's really broken down into 6 or 7 buckets, depending on if you are, if you own a business and you're self-employed, or if you're an employee, right? So number one, most important, is the financial freedom account, right? Like, it's to be able to, how do you pay yourself first so that you have money to put in real estate, to put into stocks, to put into commodities, to put into business, right? Like, you've got to funnel the money there first, right? Number two, which to me is even more important than that, is your financial freedom education, right? Like, how do you get educated to learn how to manage your cash flow? How do you get educated on how to invest in the stock market, to invest in real estate, to invest in commodities, right? You can't, the only way you can reduce your risk is by increasing your expertise and your know-how and your knowledge, right? And so that's number two. Number three is what I call your financial freedom savings account, which, that's long-term savings where, I mean, I just spent 3 weeks on vacation with my family. We went, you know, in Costa Rica, in Atlanta, and just paid cash for that. Plus, my business has still paid me while I was there, right? In 2014, just 2 years after I had started this management system, I paid cash, which was about 20 grand, to go spend 3 weeks in Brazil to travel and watch, you know, I wanted to watch Lionel Messi play in the World Cup with Argentina. I wanted to see the actual World Cup played in Brazil. So we did that.
That's awesome.
One of them that was on my list was a freaking fence, dude. Like, I don't know if where you're at in your stage of life, but for me, like, I have kids and a yard, and now all of a sudden the thing I wanted to pay on my long-term savings was a freaking fence. And dude, fences cost way more than I ever thought, just so you know. Like, you got to get the most strip. It costs money. Like, life costs money, right? So long-term savings, your financial freedom savings for long-term. And then I call your fun account, right? Like, this is money that you get to spend just like to go celebrate life today. So, I mean, like, if I go out to lunch with some associates, I'm taking it out of my fun account. Like, if we want to roll up to Deer Valley for the weekend, you know, and get a nice suite, we take it out of our play account, right? So it's just kind of like it nabs that spender in you. And like, for me, I have to force me to use that account because I'm naturally like a hoarder, right? But some of you guys might be spenders, right? So you kind of have to regulate how much you're spending, you know? After that, you know, after your fun account, one of my most passionate ones is my giveaway account, right? Like, be able to give money away and contribute. Like, our goal this year, we just are finalizing our foundation, the WGR Give Project. So our target is to give Christmas to 200 people in our local community this year. Last year we did 100. And we've learned how to raise money besides the giveaway, right? So I matched, like, everyone that donated. There was $4,500 last year. I personally matched it, me and my wife did, so now we had $9,000 to create Christmas for 100 people, right? So there's the giveaway fund. How many is that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm trying to think what other else. How many did I roll through right there? And then one, two, that if you are a business owner or self-employed, and what's important on this, Chris, is most people think that they're business owners and they're really self-employed, right? Like, if you have to go to work and do the fucking job and to make the money, then you're an employee of yourself, right? Mm. A business owner, even defined by the government, is you can leave the business for 1 year, and when you come back, the business is still growing and making money, right? So most people aren't business owners. They're self-employed people. And so if you are self-employed, or a business owner, most self-employed people run their business as like through a pass-through, like an LLC or an S-Corp, which really is just a part of you. It's not necessarily an extension, right? A lot of people think it's an extension. You have to get into a C-Corp to actually be an extension, right? Mm-hmm. So, but part of that is you have to pay taxes, right? Like, the government wants their money. So I call that bucket the country donations. Country donations sounds better to me. But one of the things you have to learn with managing your cash flow is, how do I pay less to the government and keep more for what I'm working on, right? Because I don't know about you, dude, but I totally believe how I can run my money is a billion times better than what's happening in Washington.
Yep.
I mean, $20 trillion in debt, yep, still running over a $1 trillion a year deficit. That, to me, It's not real, dude. It's Fugazi, right? It's just Fugazi, right? So that's the country donations account there, and I feel like I'm missing one of the accounts though. So let me run. So you've got the FFA, FFE, long term savings, giveaway, play. Country donations. Dude, I swear I'm missing one, but I can't remember it off the top of my head. So
it's all perfect. Awesome. Awesome. And we have Misha Rees says, Colton, you're amazing. Keep loving on people and crushing the real estate industry.
Oh, awesome. Thanks, Misha. Appreciate you checking in.
Got a fan. Love it. Love it. So when people start using these systems, would you recommend they check it once a day, once a week, once a month? What's the optimal amount?
Yeah, so I operate on, you know, I really have five core values that are governed by three principles, right? PMA, all day long, positive mental attitudes, number one core value, right? Number two is the it factor. And to me, the it factor is you just go make shit happen. There's no formula to do it. It's just like, go do it, right? The third value for me, core value, is create massive value for anyone. I don't care if it's the bank teller, the guy checking you out at Walmart, your client, whoever, just go create value. People that are watching this stream, like, create value for them. Yeah. Number four is have a shit ton of fun. Everything you do is about fun. If you're waking up and you're miserable and you're not enjoying your life, like, you got to stop immediately. This life is mortal. You're going to die one day, so enjoy it, right? And then number five is you must – for me, I must have a burning desire to create massive wealth and financial freedom. And unfortunately, that desire was not just buried into you. In fact, you were blueprinted to think that money is – I'm speaking for most people. I don't know your background, but I'm guessing that you never suffered to have food in your belly or a roof over your head.
Correct.
Right. So me neither, man. I think we got it worse than most other people. Like, I think we have it worse than people that are poor because they feel pain. We never fucking felt the pain, dude. We felt the comfort and we stayed in this little bubble and we thought, you know what I mean? If I can have that 9 to 5 pays me 50, 60 grand a year and prepare for retirement one day, I'm set. Right. But that is a fucking lie. Right. And so part of that is you have to breed that desire for wealth and financial freedom into you. Okay. And they're governed on three principles. Number one is urgency. Like, you have to take action now. Number two is transparency. Be very transparent on your action and your results. Not because you're afraid that you need to be held, I guess, to a standard, sort of speak, but because unless you are aware, you cannot correct. You cannot course correct, right? So transparency is number two. And number three is a high level of accountability. Because if you want to reach a certain state, a certain level in your life, specifically finances, if you want to do that, you must be held at a high level of accountability, right? Yes. And unfortunately, and you probably experienced this, we all have this fear of success, right? And to me, fear of success is like, it's like this, it's almost challenging for people to break through because you're either afraid that I won't be able to do it, like I can't make it happen, or you do make it happen, and now all of your mistakes and your skeletons come out. The people are going to know you're a fucking loser, and like, so you get stuck in this limbo of no action, right?
Yeah. So how do you break through that?
Massive action, dude. Like, I want you to think about this. I'm going to go all biblical on you for a second, baby. Right? So we all know the story of Adam and Eve, right? Like, taught in the book of Genesis. One of the things that happened is Eve took the fruit. She ate it first. She was beguiled by the serpent, right? Everyone knows the story. And so what happened is, well, obviously, my woman went. I got to take it now. Adam goes, eats the fruit too, right? But all of a sudden, it created fear in them, right? And God and Jesus came to see Adam, and he hid himself and put leaves over him as like an apron to cover him. And when he finally came out to talk to God and Jesus, they said, Adam, dude, what's up, man? Why are you hiding? What's going on? And he said, because I was naked and I was scared. I was naked and I was afraid, right? So this fear takes us away, and call it God, call it source energy, whatever, universe, whatever you want to describe it as, but fear takes you away from that confidence and that love and that belief. Right? The only way, fear doesn't go away, right? Like, you can't just get rid of fear, must face fear. I must face fear. And the only way to face fear is by taking some massive action. And you can increase how quickly you take action by increasing your knowledge and your belief and changing your blueprint, right? So if I have more knowledge in investing in the stock market, I'll feel more confident to take the action. I'll take the action. Boom. All of a sudden, now I'm moving forward. So massive action is important.
awesome. And do you have a specific regimen or discipline of how your day looks like in terms of adding knowledge, adding that information to you so that you can be prepared to take that massive action?
Yeah, for sure. Every day I look at, okay, what are the negotiables and non-negotiables in my life? Mm-hmm. And I think there's a myth that's been taught in the idea of time management, right? We've all heard to prioritize your schedule. Have you ever heard that? Prioritize your schedule? Mm-hmm. I think it's a lie, right? It's not about prioritizing the schedule. It's about scheduling your priorities, right? Okay. Don't worry about all this shit you got to fucking do. That's a conversation, man. That's all people tugging at you, right? What must you do? For me, I've defined it on my priorities is number one is God. Number two is my family. Number three are the people that I'm involved with on a day-to-day basis and business. Okay. So how do I nurture that? Number one is first thing every day, if God's my priority, that's the first thing I tend to. I have conversations with God, right? And so through prayer and meditation is the number one way that I start to start my day off, right? Number two is I take that prayer and I direct it with compassion and gratitude and forgiveness to the people that are most important. Number one, it's my family. Number two, it's my business associates. And then it fans out from there, right? I do a lot of journal writing. I do a lot of just writing in my targets. So, I mean, I'm up anywhere depending on the week and depending on what time I go to bed, anywhere from 4:30 to 5:30, starting this morning routine of getting my day off right. And the other thing too that's been huge for me is my health, right? Like part of my morning routine is I got to blend up my pound and a half of power greens so that throughout the day I'm putting the nutrients in me. I have the energy and that sets it off. Then I get to doing like, okay, what's my most important thing that's going to drive me to the results I want to have, right? I get the model to follow. Mm-hmm. What's the action that gets the result? For me, it's generating customers. Mm-hmm. Every business that I'm involved in, I cannot do it if there's no customers to service. So I generate customers to my business, number one. Number two is I improve the customer service along the way, right? So, and then as the day goes by, sometimes you start to fall in reactive mode, and as reactive mode, I just step back, take a deep breath, and say, what's the next most important step? What's between now and right now, so it's 5:30 my time, between now and 6 p.m., what's my most important thing? To be focused here with Chris, right? So that's what I'm aiming to do is be focused here. But I'll be honest, today I had a fucking bombshell dropped on me. I got a $1.2 million commercial deal that's supposed to close today. And one of the banks, Banner Bank, and I'll just put this out there, never fucking use Banner Bank. Banner Bank said, hey, we're not going to fund on this deal now because, which is stupid, I got my other banker on the line. He thinks he can have it funded in 2 weeks. But either way, when you're dealing with $1.2 million and several people in a transaction, that can throw your head off a little bit, right? And so I had to regroup. I had to obviously take that and make it a priority now and get it fixed, but then get back onto track to what action steps I needed to take to move forward with my life.
Powerful, man. Powerful. I love it. And what you're doing is you have the disciplines to give yourself that presence so that you're able to take a step back and be like, all right, refocus, you know, like wipe it off, wipe the sweat off, get all the shit off. All right, back in the game. You know, I love that. Yep. you're creating that environment. And we have a lot of comments coming in. I love it. I love it. So everyone who's out there, please keep the comments and questions coming. You are rocking it, Colton. By the way, type in Colton, C-O-L-T-O-N right now if you're loving this guy because he's rocking it. So we had Shamika says, Colton looks like Marky Mark from back in the day.
Dude, I hear Marky Mark and I hear Val Kilmer all the time. Like, I don't know what that's all about.
And then Jay says, I think he looks more like Donnie Wahlberg. And then Shamika said, yeah, I was trying to decide which one. Now we have a question. What Raymond says, what if that's just a story? And I'm not sure what specifically you're referring to, Raymond, but what if that's just a story linked to controlling chaos? Oh, do you truly believe Adam's new words like naked way back then? I'm not sure.
Dude, I think that's just a fucking story. Dude, yeah. Everything is a fucking story, man. Like, we're making it all up. Mm-hmm. Like, my point is like this conversation you're having in your head, there's two times that you need to pay attention to it, or two things you need to do with it. One is pay attention to it when you're writing the story. If you're not writing the story, get the fuck out of the conversation.
Damn. That's the truth right there. All right. And then
like so many times, like I used to stress so much in trying to convince myself on how to be positive. And what I realized is I don't need to convince myself to be positive. I need to just ignore that conversation and focus over here.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so there's like the conversation that like you're not positive and you're giving that, you're like fighting it, you're resisting that conversation when it's just like there's that, that's bullshit. That's just like the small mind, the ego mind, whatever is trying to distract me. I am fucking positive. I'm the most positive fucking person I know. Let's get back to work.
But dude, I think even that right there, the fact that you're saying I'm the most positive person I know, that's still the conversation, man.
Damn,
I'm saying leave the negative out, leave the positive out, and just back up and just observe for a second what's going on. And then back up one more step and observe that you're observing. And then you'll realize that, dude, everything that is around us is just stemming from our head and our inner world. You connect your mind and your heart. Now you can create anything you want. I mean, think about it, dude. Fucking Elon Musk is trying to fly people to Mars to establish another colony.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Would you have even thought that, like, 10 years ago, we would be talking like this and live streaming it, or even 30, I mean, people 30 years ago, they would have never imagined this shit, right? But now it's here.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So the stuff that's not even here yet is not even thought up yet. And it's going to be coming out of like nowhere, and it's going to be created. And life is awesome, right? Like, there is nothing to be afraid of. And if you feel fear, embrace it, man. Like, hug that shit. Hug the shit out of that life. You know what I'm saying?
So how does that look in reality? Like, someone experiences fear in, let's say, making calls or, you know, having a confronting conversation. How do they embrace that and, like, love it?
Totally. You got to process that. You got to allow the emotion to process. It doesn't mean that you're not going to feel anxiety or doubt or depression or anger or any of that, right? You're going to experience that. And a lot of time you just need to process it and let it burn through. Mm-hmm. And once you can burn through and process that, then you can feel a little bit better. Mm-hmm. I mean, one of the things right in front of my face, I'll rip it off my wall, and it's probably backwards on here, but it's called the emotional guidance scale, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So on the top is the feel good zone, and on the bottom is the feel bad zone. Okay. So I'm always asking me or my team, dude, where's your emotional guidance scale at? Right. So I'm checking in. I'm at anger right now. I am angry. So, all right, how can I feel just a little bit better? Well, you know what? I'm not angry anymore, but I'm just worried and I just have some doubt. Well, worry feels better than anger, right? Okay, now I'm not doubtful anymore. I'm just pessimistic. I'm just bored, right? Boredom is a hell of a lot better than being worried and doubtful, right?
Yes.
And then you just keep stepping up your emotion to where you can get into manifestation zone. I mean, anything from joy to contentment, like, you can manifest whatever it is you want, but it's being aware. Where am I at with my emotional state? What can I do to raise it? And there's certain things you can do to raise your state. Change your physiology, change your thoughts and your focus, change your language, right? One of the things that I do, look at this. I literally sit on this ball so that I can bounce my shit around and get moving, right? I got another board over here I can stand on and twist around and get moving. Like, change your state, change your mind, change your words.
Wow. That's epic, dude, epic. Raymond said, I'm trying to figure out how you can have so much control as an entrepreneur or go-getter. Why is the stories not the first party story? Why use God or biblical stories? I would rather hear why should we reach out to you? He's saying.
So that's the reason why is because that's my background. I mean, I'm 32 years old. I grew up in a religion, and that's what I anchored into my belief system. That's the fucking story I was told, right? It has nothing to do with reaching out to me or reaching out to God or having control. In fact, the more you can just release control and realize you have no fucking control over everything, that, like, you are seriously like one – and Gary Vee talks about this – one in 400 fucking trillion chance that you came out of your mom's vagina. Like, think about that, dude. Like, it's a fucking miracle that you're here.
Yes.
Right? Yes. Like, just – stop fucking questioning everything and start fucking doing.
Yeah. Dude, I love it. I love it. The action. So what else do we need to know to be able to start doing this financial freedom thing that you are freaking a master at, bro?
So I think there's really four major things when you want to create anything in your life, whether it's financial freedom, whether it's health, whether it's relationships. So number one is identify the result that you want and find the model that you want to follow or that – for example, like, if you know someone has the results you want, what are they doing to get those results? Follow exactly what they do. Mm. Number two is have a coachability index. Like, how coachable are you? You got to be a level 10 coach, but you got to be willing to take feedback and say, take out those words. You know the three famous words. I know that, right? Like, take that out of your vocabulary and be open to being coachable. And then when a coach or a mentor asks you to do something, you do it. Go take some action. Number three is you got to look at your believability index, right? Like, why is it even possible, right? Like, believe in the nothing that can become something. Mm. And then number four is just focus on the basics. Those are really the fundamentals right there. Tony Robbins talks about this all the time. The enemy to execution is complexity. Mm. I mean, just like Raymond is asking these questions, you're making everything too fucking complex, dude. Just simplify it. Like, think about what we have to do when we wake up. Well, we got to breathe, so that's happening. We got to put some food in us, so we got to do that. We need to put some water into us. We got to piss. We got to shit, you know. If we don't want to smell around people, we got to shower. Like, okay, now what? Does the rest of my life, do I really need to do anything? No, I don't need to do anything. But what can I go do? Well, I can go serve people on a high level with the gifts that I've been given. So what gifts have you been given? Go give that. Go deliver that to the world.
How do people analyze and take inventory of their gifts?
Great question. So I do two very important activities. Number one is what I call Smart Week. That's where I spend 2 to 3 hours with myself every single week, and I have an agenda that I follow, right? So I'm checking on that inventory. I'm always checking in very first with my victories. Number two is I'm checking in with my lead measures and my lag measures. Okay. Number three is I'm checking in with my 90-day priorities. Number four is I'm checking in with my commitments from the last 7 days that I committed to. And then number five is I'm having some positive information come into me, some sort of positive message. And then number six after that is I'm then opening up a dialogue, a conversation with myself of where do I got to go to close the gap to get from where I am to where I want to go in the next 7 days. So many times we're thinking long term, but dude, let's think like right now, what's the next most important thing? So that's number one step is what I call Smart Week. Number two step is what I call Smart Day. So it's basically a miniature version of that meeting that I have once a week. And I do that daily for 20 minutes as I end the day. Like right before I finish this conversation, before I started this conversation, I ran my Smart Week right here, or my Smart Day for tomorrow, because as soon as I'm done here, I got a jet and go to my daughter's preschool graduation. And from after that, after preschool graduation, we're going to have some celebration dinner, right? And then we're going to be putting to bed. So I've already got tomorrow's day and priorities panned out. So right here, I've got tomorrow's priorities. And then in the morning, as I get here and see if anything else is falling on my plate, I'll rank them. Number one, number two, number three, number four, number five. I'll start with the next most important thing. I'll see how much time it'll take me. 30 minutes, I execute. Then once I'm done with that, I look at my thing. Number two, how much time will that take? I got it. Boom, I execute, right? Every day we finish our day, there's more shit that we have to get done. Like, I don't know if you noticed this. Like, every dang day we finish up, there's more stuff we got to do, right?
Yep.
So it's like, okay, what's the next most important thing? And sometimes the next most important thing is not doing anything at all. Like, you got to back off and just chill and just enjoy and just be.
Yeah. Damn, man. You're like freaking lit. I love it. Like on fire. So my question is, did you put all this into the Financial Freedom Nation, or is there like the Life of Colton system that people can buy to learn this?
Oh, dude, no. Financial Freedom Nation is really going to teach you the fundamentals of the cash flow system so that you can – the idea is when you enter Financial Freedom Nation and when you leave it, that you already have your account set up and you're already depositing money into it, because what's most important is not the dollar amounts that's being put in there, but the habit of putting it in there, right? Rule number one in business, and you are a business even by yourself, your personal world and finances are a business. Rule number one is don't run out of fucking cash, right? Like, stop running out of cash and over leveraging yourself, okay? So that's number one. Smart Day, Smart Week, that's more stuff that I teach in our coaching and training and mastermind platforms. That's like deeper stuff, like more one-on-one spent time.
Cool. Cool, man. So what else do we need to know to be able to reach that financial freedom? You've given us a lot of practical steps, a lot of systems. What else do we need?
So check this out. And I have a monthly conversation with my CPA who runs all of our P&Ls, and we're reviewing our statements and things like that. And I asked him, I said, and he runs a lot of small businesses. You know, small businesses to me are, you know, if you're under $150 million a year, you're still probably a small business, right? Or maybe even more than that, right? So even if we do have businesses, they're small businesses, right? And I said, what's the number one failure that you see in people's businesses? And he says that they don't do a cash flow management system, right? Like they just don't do it. So as I look back on my journey from figuring out that I could be financially free to actually making it a reality, mm-hmm. it was one simple factor. It was not where I knew to invest my money. It was not who I knew. It was not what I knew. It was simply that I took action on managing my cash flow, right? Like that is the one thing. Everyone else is looking so far in the distance, but the one thing that takes you from the top of the hourglass to the bottom, that little bottleneck right there, is just learn to manage your cash flow. You do that, you will grow and be financially free. And I don't care if it's your goal to be $5,000 or $50,000 or $5 million a month in income, residual income, right? Passive income, but it's like the fact that you just flow it, you can create it. You can live life on your terms. And what's really, really cool, like once you get beyond that and you're mastering that cash flow management, and this is where people want to start, but they got to back up and do that cash flow management, mm-hmm. is then you can create money out of thin air, right? Like you can launch – we live in the coolest time in the history of the world with the internet. You can launch products that create massive value, and one day you don't have any money flowing in, and the next day you've got $3,500 flowing in,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
Or, for example, I just had a deal that I actually passed up on it, but the guy needed a $50,000 12-month loan to carry his business, and I literally at the same time had U.S. Bank offer me $25,000 at 2% interest for the next 18 months. I could have then leveraged my credit, lent it over to him and charged him 12%. I just literally made 10% return on money that wasn't even my money. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So you can start to then invent shit out of thin air. However, people want to start doing those type of loans without managing their cash flow. People want to start doing those type of loans without taking money from their financial education account and learning how to do that stuff. Mm. They just want to do it without putting that effort in to learn it.
So
or the worst is everyone's learning and 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 they just never start to do.
How do people get out of that trap? I know it's like just do it. Obviously, that's
do it right now. Like, what's the one thing that you know you must do to move one step forward? Go fucking do it right now. Like, if you want to lose weight, where does that start? Your nutrition and your exercise. Great. Go get some fucking vegetables and put them in your mouth right now. Yes. Stop trying to come up with any other complicated plan, but go put greens in your body, right?
Yeah. How did you learn to be such a simple, like, get it done person?
Dude, a lot of it probably stems back from my dad. Dude, from as long as I remember, is up at 3:30 in the morning just hustling, right? And long as I've known, I mean, he's the one that taught me you can't do a half-assed job in life, right? Like you just can't do it. Unless you want to be average, right? Do half-assed, right? But if you want to be above average, if you want to be extraordinary, and actually, you want to know how I learned that was, I remember I was in high school. I can't remember if it was middle school or high school. My job was to clean the horse stalls out, right? I don't know if you've ever cleaned horse stalls before, but it sucks, dude. When it rains and it's muddy and it's stinky and it sucks. I hated it, right? And I would do a half-assed job doing it. And I remember my dad would come home late from whatever work or whatever, and he'd rip my ass out of bed at midnight, and he would say to me, Colton, you can't do a half-assed job cleaning up horse shit. And he'd make me go out and clean up the horse shit in the middle of the night because I did a half-assed job.
How many times did that happen? I would imagine you learned.
Oh, my gosh, dude. It happened several times before I finally got the message delivered that it's like, okay, I can't do this. I just need to do it right the first time. It'll save me some time and energy if I just do it right.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. So no half-assed jobs. I love it. Anything else that we need to know to just get it done, to manage our finances effectively, to build this financial freedom?
Yeah, a couple things that I can shout out would be, number one is, who do you surround yourself with? Like, one of the things I've learned was probably my biggest downfall, because I really love people and I want to serve people. And I got to this point where I realized I wanted it more for other people than they wanted it for themselves. So what I had to realize is I'm not Jesus Christ. I'm not the Savior. It's not my responsibility to save these people, right? So once I could figure that out, I realized, well, wait a second. I got to get around people that think like me or even on a higher level. Mm. And I had to cut a lot of people out of my life. Like, I had to get rid of those people that no matter how much I cared about them and loved them, like, I just couldn't be around them anymore. Mm. that's huge for me, is who I surround myself with.
Yeah. And did that happen like when you started going to the Millionaire Mind, or how recent?
I think even after that, like, I mean, that was, I started becoming aware of it, you know? And then actually what helped me really make that choice, to be honest, is when I started, my income started going up. Like it's funny when your income goes up, it's like a volume for you, and it's a volume for the people around you. It's going to turn up more on how and who you really are and how and who they really are. Mm-hmm. I started to explode more as a person that delivers value, and they started to explore more as people that were jealous and that criticized me. And I said, well, fuck, dude, I got enough doubt in my head. I don't need you freaking clawing me down as well. So I'm like, dude, I'm out. Peace, dude.
Yeah. Wow. And have you found that mainly focusing on your businesses, and you're still involved in church community?
You know what? I don't have anything to do with religion anymore.
Wow. That's interesting. What happened there?
I just started to understand how patterns work, brain patterns, neurolinguistics, psychology. And not that I think church is a great fit for people that want to be involved. I just decided that's not the result that I want in my life. So I needed to associate myself with the action that caused the results that I wanted. And so it just, I didn't want that pattern in my life. That's it.
So you mentioned God earlier, and you talked about universe, source, creator. Is there any spiritual teachings that you focus on now, or concepts?
Most everything spiritual for me is just is prayer and meditation. And prayer, I use kind of from, if you heard of the book Code of the Extraordinary Mind, he has a meditation that goes through. It's called six phase meditation. And I do kind of a different variable. I do six phase prayer where, I mean, you think about prayer, you're really just talking with yourself. It's really conversing with yourself. I look at it as on my knees, having a conversation out loud with my fucking self, basically. But I go through the phase of number one of compassion. I spend 2 to 5 minutes on compassion and conversing about compassion on who, first off, where I've received compassion and where I want to deliver compassion. Number two is I spend 2 to 5 minutes on gratitude, on what I'm grateful for myself and those people around me. And then number three, as I spend 2 to 5 minutes on forgiveness, number one is forgiving myself. Like, if there's a message that you guys could take from here, is be able to forgive yourself. And if you want to know the formula to forgive yourself, is simply say, I forgive myself for this. And like, I didn't know better. I did it wrong, whatever. Like, I forgive myself. And then forgive those around you. Like, there's, when you can learn to forgive, you can release so much negative energy from your soul. And then from there, I go to the visualization where I kind of play a wouldn't it be nice game. So wouldn't it be nice if I was earning $1.5 million a year? Wouldn't it be nice if I was flying on a private jet? Wouldn't it be nice if I was, you know, I received some unforeseen opportunities today that made me a bunch of money? Or wouldn't it be nice that I spent 21 days with my family in Costa Rica? Or wouldn't it be nice that, whatever, you can say whatever. Wouldn't it be nice if I weighed 170 pounds and at 10% body fat, right? Like, you get to be creative during that time frame. And then the fifth part of that prayer is that I visualize my perfect day. So I start from the very morning and I see myself saying prayer. I see myself meditating. I see myself writing in my journal or reading my book or whatever it is I want to do. I see myself kissing my wife on the lips saying, I love you. I see myself kissing my kids and wishing them a rock star day. I see myself putting together my green drink so it's ready and prepared, because that's really important to me. I see myself, you know, depending on what I have, having a coaching call with one of my my agents here or one of the people on my team. I see myself going and generating leads. I mean, I still spend 2.5 hours when I work, 2.5 hours on the phone generating leads, either for my sales business or recruiting talent or something. Like, I see myself doing that. Then I see myself, you know, doing what Monday through Thursday, I do a Facebook Live for my Fearless Agent business. I see myself doing that. I see myself doing an accountability check-in with my team at noon every day. I see myself running and going to the gym at 12:30 to 2 o'clock every day. I see myself coming back and doing a quick meditation. I see myself then laying out whatever it is I want to do throughout the rest of my day. I see myself playing a left, center, right with it's a dice game with my daughters. Right. So I visualize my entire day. And then the sixth part of that prayer is I just say thank you for wrapping me in a warm blanket of worthiness and for all the blessings. And I appreciate the blessings being on me.
Damn, man. Dude, you have like the whole system of like, I would say the perfect life. It sounds like, you know, I'm sure shit comes up, shit comes your way, but it sounds like you've literally like worked on every corner of the life to have a well-rounded, well-balanced life. And I seriously acknowledge you, Colton, for putting it all together, man. That's a fucking
cool, man.
It's a masterpiece.
Thank you. Yes. I appreciate that.
Yes. You're welcome. You're welcome. So where can people find you moving forward? Like where are they going to see you in the next coming years and decades?
Oh man, dude, you're gonna see me all over the freaking internet, that's for sure.
you sound like Grant Cardone, man.
No, dude, so right now I've got two candidates that I've boiled down to. I'm hiring what I call the media director, social media director. Their whole job full time is to help me take my content and level it up, right? Like I've got to a point where to grow my social media, I have two options. One is disband everything I'm doing and go full time on that, which it's be silly.
Yeah.
Or number two is I hire someone who's really skilled at it and get them to capture the essence of me and just really get that message out there to people. So that's what we're working on. So you can follow me on my Facebook page, facebook.com/Colton J. Lindsay. Mm-hmm. You can follow me on the Instagram, the WGR. Mm-hmm. You can follow me on YouTube. Just search Colton Lindsay on YouTube. And then if you want to get into the Financial Freedom Nation course, you have a link, Chris. I don't know how you get that in front of them. Click on that link and do honestly, like we are offering it at like ridiculously low price, like right now, because once we're finished doing some adjustments with it, we're going to sell it for a lot more, right? Probably anywhere from $1,500 to $2,000 just to get into the program. So right now though, through the link that Chris has, like literally you're going to have 8 weeks of 1 hour training that's dissecting that system I was sharing with you guys earlier. And from start to finish, when you leave that course, you will be putting into action your financial cash flow management system. You can literally get into that course on Chris's link for only $97. Like it's literally $12 a week to get into it. It's less than a Starbucks a day. Like you'd be crazy not to do it if you want to master your financial freedom.
That's badass, man. Badass. So last minute takeaways you want our audience walking away with.
Dude, just wake up and be grateful to be here and don't waste your fucking gift called life. Just embrace it, man.
Damn. Spoken like a master. I love it. Colton, dude, thank you for coming on here and delivering massive value. Definitely, hands down, one of the best, most realist interviews that we've had yet, man. Thank you for bringing your gift to us, to the world, man. And keep it the fuck up, dude.
Thanks, man. Appreciate you.
You're welcome. I'll see you soon, okay?
See ya.